campy to some.
A nightmare to others! Oh, God! Oh, Jesus Christ!
But I will give you a message.
The message of death!
Mrs. Beale, we're needed.
The matron, take them away!
Oh! Dada!
Are you men enough to fight with me?
Anyone who opposes me will be destroyed.
Greetings, I am the Big Daddy D, David Mabley. And for you, this might be the most important YouTube video you have ever watched. But for me, it's Friday afternoon. When do the pubs open?
And I am Luke Murphy, and Jean Claude Van Damme, why the hell are you making me watch this film?
We are going to be taking a look at Street Fighter the movie from 1994. And this is actually a review that was requested by a number of our viewers.
Again, we know where you live.
The Street Fighter 2 video game was a revelation in the arcades and on home consoles, an incredibly popular and fun game to play that would later open up the door for other successful fighting game franchises like Mortal Kombat, Tekken, and of course, Rise of the Robots.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that last one. Capcom became interested in the idea of a Street Fighter movie adaptation around about 1993, and this was likely based around the excitement generated by the sight of Jackie Chan playing a few of the characters from the video game in the movie City Hunter, a movie that we have obviously covered previously.
By this point, video game movie adaptations hadn't really been a major deal in Hollywood. Previously, there was The Wizard, which turned out to be nothing more than a massive feature-length advertisement for Nintendo.
I love the power glove. So bad.
And of course we had that bloody awful Super Mario Brothers movie that Bob Hoskins would later describe as a fucking nightmare and the biggest mistake of my career. The film also starred Dennis Hopper as King Cooper, which is oddly fitting considering that Hopper was hooked on so many drugs at the time, he probably thought that he was a giant fucking lizard already.
Monkey!
But Capcom were confident that their movie would avoid the same pitfalls that plague Nintendo's mustachioed mascot and reached out to Stephen E. D'Souza. Now, if you don't know who D'Souza is, then you may be interested to know that he was a well-respected Hollywood screenwriter that had scripted the likes of Commando, Die Hard 1 and 2, 48 Hours, The Running Man, and later on that bloody awful Judge Dredd movie from 1995. D'Souza not only got the job of writing the script for the movie, but he also ended up directing it as well.
Capcom wanted to see the movie in the cinemas by Christmas of 1994, and they wanted to see every single character from the game included. That also meant the four brand new characters that had just appeared in Super Street Fighter 2. But D'Souza argued with Capcom at the idea of getting all 16 characters in a 90-minute movie and was able to convince them to bring it down to a mere 7 characters instead.
Now, the reason for this, D'Souza argued, was because 7 was the maximum number of characters that audiences would be able to keep in their heads during the movie. Now, there was a reason why there were 7 dwarfs, or there were 7 wonders of the world. There's a reason why it's the Magnificent 7, which is a remake of the Japanese movie The Seven Samurai. It is the number of characters an audience can keep in its head at any time.
And when the Capcom bigwigs didn't believe him, D'Souza challenged them right there and then in the room to name every single one of the miniature diamond miners from Walt Disney's Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. And not a single person was able to do this. So D'Souza set 7 as a compromise, and Capcom, dissuaded by the parlor trick, agreed to this limit.
And to be fair, it's not a bad trick for D'Souza to pull off, but in the end, it was all for nothing. He eventually ended up having to add more and more characters to the film as a bargaining chip when he had to deal with Capcom's executive meddling that took place throughout the production.
And in the end, pretty much all 16 characters from the game ended up in the film. The only exception to this was poor old Fei Long, although that might have been because the character was an obvious Bruce Lee copycat, and the producers didn't want to get into trouble from the Lee family estate.
In his place was the new character Captain Sawada, who was created as a compromise. Capcom actually wanted the actor Kenya Sawada to play Ryu, but his English skills weren't strong enough for the role. So this new character was created as a compromise, although I can't understand why they just didn't call him Captain Fei-Long.
A lot of the movie was being shot on the Gold Coast, so the Australian Actors Guild demanded that an Australian actor was included in the film as well. D'Souza added Cammy to the cast and had her played by former soap opera actress turned pop star Kylie Minogue as a compromise.
Yes, this is literally the only reason why Kylie is in the film. Now, this would probably explain why she doesn't have a right lot to do throughout the movie, apart from say, yes, Colonel, and shout thrust kick during her brief moments of fighting. And even then, that looked like it was dubbed on in post-production.
And to be honest, in trying to shoehorn every character into the film, a lot of them ended up being in a role that was completely unlike how they were in the game. For example, Chun-Li is now a television news reporter rather than an Interpol agent, with her camera crew consisting of E. Honda and Balrog. Typically in the video game, Balrog was depicted as a villain working for Bison, so this was certainly not accurate to what people were expecting.
Other characters like poor old Dr. Dalsim, oh dear, T-Hawk and the aforementioned Captain Sawada pretty much end up doing bugger all, but we'll see more of that as we go through the film. The only exceptions to this are our two main roles.
The two main cast members were attached from the very beginning. Capcom wanted Jean Claude Van Damme to play the part of Guile. Now, in retrospect, this might seem like an odd choice, considering that the all-American character from the film has now got a thick Belgian accent. JCVD had the martial arts skills and action movie experience, and not to mention plenty of box office clout at the time.
Indeed. Both Kickboxer and Bloodsport have been huge successes, and even Canon Films have been able to claw back some of their massive debts with the success of Cyborg. Again, a throwback to one of our previous episodes. Please do watch our episodes on Light Force on the Apple for more on Canon Films. In 1994, Van Damme had back-to-back box office successes with Universal Soldier and Hard Target. And a number of months before Street Fighter was released, he had another massive hit with Time Cop. The film had a budget of $35 million, and Van Damme was getting a very, very big chunk of that, but Capcom obviously felt that he was worth it.
Of course, with success comes a darker price to pay. Van Damme at the time came with a lot of personal baggage and a reputation for being a pain in the arse to deal with on film sets. Not to mention a bad cocaine habit.
Allegedly.
Yes, an allegedly bad cocaine habit.
The other main cast member that was in from the beginning was Raul Julia, a legendary actor known and loved throughout the world. Julia had become a known name in Hollywood thanks to his role of Gomez Adams from the hit comedy The Addams Family, and of Proteus from the rock musical Two Gentlemen of Verona. Every villain in a movie needs some acting clout behind them, and Julia had this in spades.
Now, we've said this before here on the show, but the late, great Christopher Lee was quoted as saying that every actor has to make terrible films from time to time, but the trick is never to be terrible in them. One of the greatest examples of this is Raul Julia in the role of M. Bison for this film. The reason why Street Fighter the movie has continued to remain in the popular pop culture consciousness over other video game movie adaptations like, say, King of Fighters or...
Super Mario.
Super Mario or Double Dragon is all down to one thing and one thing only, and that is Raul Julia's performance in this film.
And he is clearly having an absolute blast, hamming it up throughout the film, but he was originally hesitant about taking the part. He was eventually convinced to do so due to his kids being massive fans of the Street Fighter 2 video game, and they encouraged him to be in the film. One of the reasons why Julia had been hesitant to appear in the film originally was because he had been very, very ill for a while, ever since finishing off work on The Addams Family Values.
He had come off a recent serious incident of food poisoning and had stomach surgery a few months previously to treat what had been rumoured at the time to be stomach cancer. But not wanting to alarm anyone, Julia, as ever the professional, kept his ill health to himself. Originally, production was going to start with Julia's dialogue-intense scene work, allowing time for the stunt team to prep and rehearse action scenes for the latter half of the shoot. But when Julia first arrived on the set, he still looked extremely pale and gaunt from his illness, and D'Souza realised that he couldn't possibly film Julia up close in his current condition.
And as a result, the schedule was rejigged and actually shot back to front, with the action scenes and the fights being filmed first, with Julia's condition less noticeable in long shots and quick cuts. This allowed Julia time to relax with his family, who were on set with him, put on some weight, and recover. What was quite nice is that the Julia family were able to make the trip into a family vacation, going swimming with porpoises, scuba diving, and later discovering the Australian outback.
Julia soon began to look healthier, and his body gradually took on more weight. This meant that the close-up shots with Bison's dialogue could then be shot afterwards and spliced in during post-production. However, if Julia was putting weight back on, the rest of the cast were losing it. When scenes were being shot in Thailand, many of the cast and crew struggled to adapt to the nation's scorching temperatures and culinary traditions. Brian Mann, who played Ryu in the film, would later say in an interview that no one knew it would be that hot and humid. We were malnourished and not accustomed to the food. Everyone lost weight. He also mentioned that upon watching the film back, you might notice that some of the actors were about 5 to 10 pounds lighter or heavier from one scene to another. Should also point out now that the main fight trainer and choreographer for the film was Benny the Jet Nikitas, who appeared in a number of Jackie Chan films, had some fantastic fight scenes with Jackie Chan. And although he was fantastic, he was basically stuck having to train all these actors and didn't have enough time to do it. So he did his best with what he did his best. But he definitely needed
more time.
More time and more people helping him.
Typically, with the sort of movies that we review on this ear show, there were a number of chaotic events going on behind the scenes, which we will be addressing as we go through the film. Let us start with the plot, because it does move along at a pretty fast pace throughout, even though it plays out like a weak plot to a James Bond film. Civil war has erupted within the fictional Asian nation of Shadaloo, which looks like every other stereotypical foreign country ever, according to America, between the forces of General M. Bison and the allied nations.
Totally not the United Nations.
Which are led by Colonel William F. Guile. Bison has captured several AN relief workers.
Totally not the Red Cross.
And via a live radio communication on news reporter Chun-Li's broadcast, Bison makes a demand to Guile that the AN secure a $20 billion ransom in 3 days, otherwise he will start killing the hostages. Guile refuses and vows to track Bison down, but his assistant, Sergeant Cammy, is only partially able to pinpoint Bison's location to the River Delta region outside of the city.
The only thing that Guile actually manages to achieve here is bringing to Bison's attention that one of the hostages is Guile's friend, Sergeant Carlos Blanca, otherwise known as Charlie. Yep, the filmmakers combined Jimmy Blanca and Charlie Nash into the same character for this film. Bison orders Charlie to be taken away to the lab for his captive scientist, Dr. Dalsim, to turn into the first of his mutated super soldiers. This basically involves a bunch of IV programs with mutagen written on it. That was the nanomachines of the 90s, folks. It explains everything. You can blame the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles for this. Mutagen turns turtles into ninjas and pizzas into xenomorphs.
Why does he find it disturbing?
Because unlike you, he's not psychotic.
As it turns out, Bison doesn't really like being called a psycho. Who would have thought that?
We are then introduced to Ryu and Ken, and oh god, what have they done to these characters?
Yes, whilst in the video game, Ryu and Ken were seen as the main heroes, in this movie, they are a couple of fast-talking con men that do dodgy deals. I half expected them to emerge from a knackered-looking Reliant supervan. Ryu and Ken attempt to swindle arms dealer Victor Sagat by providing him with fake weaponry that turn out to be Nerf guns with a realistic paint job. Sagat sees through the ruse and has Ryu fight his cage-fighting champion, Vega.
Can I just say this? The guy that plays Vega looks spot on, but he only has about 3 lines of dialogue, and even then I suspected those were dubbed on later during post-production. Vega has a number of female fans at the prize fight. One of them has a sign asking him to marry her, which she quickly discards after she sees Ryu with his top off. This becomes a regular occurrence for Ryu, as Brian Mann was seemingly going out of his way not to look like his video game counterpart at all. He doesn't wear a red headband at all, and every chance he gets, he whips his top off and goes shirtless.
Now, the fight is interrupted by Guile busting through the wall of the building in a tank that appears to have missiles mounted on it. We can just point out at this moment that this vehicle is clearly not one that is suitable for ramming down doors just to arrest civilians for violating a curfew.
In the prison grounds, Guile avoids an assassination attempt from a screaming chef. Guile handles it like this.
Was it Gordon Ramsay?
Guile handles this like it's something that happens every bloody lunchtime. I mean, maybe they should consider getting self-catering instead. Meanwhile, Vega has already made himself another set of claws out of hooks and some bamboo. He's only been in prison for an hour or so. Must be a coping mechanism.
Guile witnesses Ryu and Ken fighting Sagat's men and recruits both of them to help him find Bison in exchange for their freedom, since Sagat is Bison's main arm supplier. Guile gives Ryu and Ken a homing device and gets them to win Sagat's trust by having them stage a prison escape, faking Guile's death as part of the ruse.
At his headquarters, Bison learns of Guile's passing and mourns his loss as he wanted the honor of facing him in combat.
That's great news, General. Congratulations.
On the contrary, I mourn.
Okay.
So that he could then snap his spine. Ah, the road not taken. Bison then launches into a great villain speech where we learn that he wants to build a huge city called Bisonopolis. Not for power, not for evil, but for good. I mean, come on, it even has a food court.
I think the food court should be larger. All the big franchises will want in.
This speech is enough to bring Zangief to tears, as he appears to be the only one of Bison's followers who believes this propaganda and actually thinks that Bison is a good guy. Now, the actor that plays Zangief is also spot on too. Not only does he look like his video game counterpart, but he does a decent Russian accent and sounds like you'd expect Zangief to sound like. He is also a hugely entertaining character. He is the ultimate definition of dumb muscle.
And I love the fantastic double act that he and DJ have throughout the film. Zangief will say or do something stupid, and DJ will just give him the absolute most withering look. This double act is so good, I don't actually care that DJ is absolutely nothing like his video game counterpart. Don't care. DJ tends to get the snarkiest lines in the film, as he's not on board with Bison's brand of madness, but he's too smart to say it to his face.
Anyway. Chun-Li, who has her own agenda against Bison, stumbles across the plot while sneaking into the AN headquarters whilst dressed as a ninja for some reason. Chun-Li had planted her own tracking signal in the prison convoy that Ryu and Ken escaped in, so she is surprised to find that there is a second tracking signal. This leads her into the same room as Guile, who, shock horror, isn't dead, and is apparently a method actor as he's been laid on the table for hours. She escapes, which obviously impresses Guile.
What a screw-up. What a woman.
Why has he been laid on that table?
I have no idea.
Chun-Li and company then disguise themselves as a magic act, which they perform right in front of Bison. But come on, they've got swords there. Why don't they use them? Instead, they just go away afterwards to blow up weapons that Bison doesn't even own at that point. Sure, that's just going to inconvenience Sagat more than anything. Ken follows her into a tent because he's got a big sweaty chubby on and thinks that some afternoon tiffin is on the cards. Ryu follows, totally not because he wanted to watch.
You are a terrible, terrible person. Just want to say that now.
Bison offers his homemade currency, Bison dollars, and reveals his plans to kidnap the Queen of England. Sagat isn't impressed.
This money isn't worth the paper it's printed on.
Every Bison dollar will be worth 5 British pounds once I've kidnapped their queen.
Personally, I would love me some Bison dollars in a nice glass display case. Also, sadly, the Queen of England is no longer with us. Mm. So if Bison decides that he wants to capture King Charles instead, he'll end up having to keep him. We don't want him back. Hashtag not my king.
Wow. Bison and Sagat have a standoff that Ryu and Ken accidentally walk into the middle of. Chun-Li announces from a live video feed that they've got a large vehicle filled with dynamite that is about to crash into their camp and blow up their weapons.
Zangief's solution is,
quick, change the channel!
Leading to another exasperated look, not only from DJ, but also from Ryu and Ken this time as well. I'll say it again, Zangief and DJ, great double acts.
Chun-Li and her crew are captured despite the weapons being destroyed. Bison inducts Sagat and Vega along with Ryu and Ken into his organization, whilst Chun-Li is sent to Bison's private chambers for a nice cocktail dress and a private interview.
Meanwhile, Honda and Balrog are taken to the torture chamber where a subtle masturbation joke is made.
Honda, give me a hand. I've only been in jail 2 hours. Maybe next month.
Moving swiftly on. Thank you for that disturbing image. I will never be able to look at Eddie Honda's 100-hand slap ever again.
Meanwhile, Guile plans to distract Bison in his invisible speedboat. Where did that come from? That has Guile's name printed across it, white on black, clear as anything. Name, rank, everything. He may as well have his PIN number and his sort code and account number on there as well.
But before Guile can begin his mission, he is impeded by the snooty and completely cowardly Deputy Secretary of the AN, who informs Guile that the decision has been made to pay Bison the ransom. And bloody hell, it's only Simon Callow. I really, really, really hope they paid him well for this. This is not exactly a stretch for him by any means necessary. But it is a fun little part, even though he's playing the most stereotypically smug British man ever.
This is apparently the reason why Giles' team are called the Allied Nations rather than the United Nations, as they so obviously are. The real-life UN actually threatened to sue the entire production into buggery because of this one scene alone in the film.
The war is cancelled. We can go home. But I'm going to commit a war crime by ignoring my orders from my superiors, who are clearly wanting to just get the hostages out of there and, you know, save lives.
That son of a bitch, Bison's ass!
Colonel, have you lost your mind?
No. You've lost your balls.
We then cut to Chun-Li in Bison's private chambers, which, by the way, are stunning. Stunning decor. They are portraits of Bison everywhere looking regal and godlike.
Can I just say at this point that Ming-Na Wen, who plays Chun-Li, her reactions to this are absolutely brilliant. She would later go on to star in the likes of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. and The Mandalorian, and she'd also did the voice of Mulan, so things did get better for her after this movie.
Chun-Li reveals that 20 years ago, the Bison killed her father. Bison does not remember attacking Chun-Li's village or killing her father. While it may have been the most defining moment of her life, to him, it was just another day at the office.
The day Bison graced your village was the most important day of your life. But for me, it was Tuesday.
Poetry. Sheer poetry. Shakespeare could not write that any better. He's sincerely sorry that he doesn't remember. Chun-Li's obsession with revenge literally means nothing to him. It is an excellently delivered line. Bison can't seem to grasp why people call him horrific and evil. And this is coming from the man who never remembers the people that he has murdered due to his enormous ego, considering them so far beneath him.
Look, just because I'm holding some people hostage and I have a chandelier made of human bones, that doesn't give people the right to call me a madman. That's just rude.
Chun-Li, it turns out, is full of surprises as she suddenly breaks her bonds and proceeds to give Bison an almighty ass-kicking. But she is distracted by the arrival of Honda and Balrog, who have been broken out of jail by Ryu and Ken. Bison takes advantage of this distraction to retreat to a little panic room and set off knockout gas, sedating them all.
Meanwhile, Guile's boat is in stealth mode, although it's not very stealthy when you're blowing up radars. So Bison decides to deal with Guile personally, using his floating desk that turns out to have a really sweet Street Fighter II arcade cabinet setup in it. It's got the sticks, the buttons, everything. We also find out that Bison's a bit of a button masher, so I bet he always played as Blanka or E. Honda.
Bison blows up Guile's boat whilst proclaiming, but it turns out Guile had escaped from the boat just in the nick of time. Guile, Cammy, and T-Hawk sneak onto the island, and here's where we get T-Hawk's 10 seconds. Yes, count them, 10 seconds of character development, which was actually dubbed much, much later in post-production.
T-Hawk, what's with the headband?
It's Cherokee. I wear it for good luck in battle. Should have brought three of them.
Sorry, that's supposed to be T-Hawk. In the game, T-Hawk is an absolute giant of a man. In the film, he's a random bloke with a headband.
Meanwhile, whilst all of this has been going on, Dr. Dalsim has interfered with the experiment to try and maintain some of Charlie's humanity by secretly altering his violent cerebral programming and replacing the footage with that of puppies, families, Dr. Martin Luther King. However, his meddling is discovered by a guard and an ensuing fight breaks out, during which Dalsim gets thrown onto the cart with all the mutagen.
The poor lad doesn't even get to throw a punch in this movie, never mind a yoga fire. Dalsim actually had more to do in that one scene from City Hunter.
In the ensuing chaos, Charlie is released from his chamber and he kills the guard to protect Dalsim. Now, this is the only thing of note that Blenker does throughout the entire movie. It's meant to be a dramatic moment when he comes out of his pod, but it just looks laughable.
I mean, just look at him. Just fucking look at him. He's got a carrot top wig and some green raver body paint on. He doesn't even seem to have gotten all that much bigger. He was supposed to have been pumped with enough mutagen and steroids throughout this process that he would have more than doubled his muscle mass and made him look like Scott Steiner. Because he's a genetic freak and he's not normal. Are you telling me there wasn't enough money left in the budget to get, what, Lou Ferrigno on the set for a day or two? Come on.
Guile arrives and sneaks into the lab where he encounters Charlie. Guile prepares to shoot Charlie to end his suffering, but Dalsim stops him, telling Guile that he doesn't have the right to do that. Bison prepares to kill the hostages by unleashing Charlie Blanca on them, but Guile emerges and fights off Bison's guards until the remaining AN forces arrive. After ordering his allies to rescue the hostages, Guile engages Bison in a personal duel.
You have made me a happy man.
Next, I'll make you a dead one.
Yeah! As Guile and Bison fight, everyone else starts scrapping as well.
So Cammy and T-Hawk fight off the Bison troopers, Ryu and Ken argue over whether to fight or flee, and DJ goes to make his escape, having re-evaluated his career choices.
My mama didn't raise no fool, baby. Oh man, I should have stayed at Microsoft.
Balrog picks up a pair of boxing gloves from somewhere, and Captain Sawada sees grainy security camera footage of Honda and Zangief fighting each other on the Bisonopolis model, which looks like a kaiju battle, complete with Godzilla sound effects. Oh, the hilarity!
Guile defeats Bison, kicking him into the control panel, but Bison's suit resuscitates him. In round two, Bison shoots lightning and can now fly. Yep.
Ryu is getting tag-teamed and teabagged by... by Sagat and Vega. But then Ken comes back to even the odds. Ken sort of does a dragon punch, and Ryu sort of does a Hadouken and a hurricane kick.
Vega gets his face burnt on an incinerator door and was actually meant to die in the movie by being impaled on his own claws. Whilst this scene was cut from the film, it can still be seen in the comic book adaptation. We were also meant to see how Sagat ends up with the massive chest scar, but this didn't make it into the final movie either.
That doesn't mean, by the way, that we're recommending you to track down the comic book adaptation. The artwork is bloody dreadful, as the artists couldn't decide whether to make the characters look like their movie counterparts or their video game counterparts. So instead they went for this weird, inconsistent look where they look goofy as hell in one panel and then downright demonic looking in another.
Guile counters Bison's Psycho Crusher with Van Damme's usual jumping spin kick, you know, the one that he does in all of his bloody movies, which knocks the dictator into his TV wall, which then explodes. This starts off a detonation countdown of the entire base for some reason.
Honda is dragged away from his fight with Zangief in a really cute moment where he says that, sorry man, I can't play anymore, leaving Zangief absolutely bewildered. Upon seeing DJ making a break for it, he discovers that Bison was in fact the bad guy all along, with DJ explaining why he worked for him despite knowing this.
Because he paid me a freaking fortune, you moron.
You got paid?
Yes. Sadly, this is the last interaction between these characters, but it is a good send-off, and it leads to Zangief doing a full-on babyface turn by siding with Ryu and Ken to help save the hostages.
Guile tries to convince Dalsim and Charlie to return with him, but they refuse, with a now bald Dalsim wishing to atone for his part in mutating Charlie. I guess the mutagen made him bald, and melted all his clothes off, and perhaps gave him stretchy arms?
Guile then flees the exploding base and reunites with his comrades as Sagat and DJ realise that the big box of cash that DJ stole on his way out was actually full of worthless Bison dollars. Ken and Ryu decide to stay in Shadaloo to help out Guile with the country's recovery. Guile makes an incredibly creepy pass at Chun-Li.
Yes.
Yeah, that hasn't aged well at all. And everyone does their victory pose from the video game as the base explodes in the background.
Yay!
We now come to the part of every review where we ask ourselves the question,
what have we watched here? I mean, dear God.
Yeah. So, the overall reception to the movie wasn't particularly favourable.
Really?
I know. The martial arts fight sequences were very, very poorly edited in places. There were far too many characters stuffed in, and, you know, often some of the dialogue, in particular from Mr. Van Damme himself, was often unintelligible.
I'm counting on you. What will prevent him from taking more hostages next month and asking for 50 billion?
All we have to do is to infiltrate someone into his gang.
I'm the Repo Man, and you're out of business.
I think D'Souza was either very brave or very naive for thinking that he could write jokey one-liners for Jean-Claude Van Damme and actually expect them to be delivered well. Even the other actors seem to be having a job understanding what he's saying, and they had the script.
But some moron just scanned me.
The film was seen for a number of years as another example, along with the Super Mario Brothers movie and anything that was directed by Uwe Boll, as another example of why adapting a video game into a movie wasn't always a good idea. However, one advantage that this film has over video game adaptations is that Street Fighter the movie is actually a rather enjoyable, fun-filled romp. It has its flaws, sure, but damn it's entertaining. When it's funny, it's bloody funny. It's meant to be goofy and light-hearted. It is very much a comedy, just one that so happens to be very, very loosely based around
very
Street Fighter.
Loosely. One of the main reasons why the film is so enjoyable is due to the great comedic villain that Raul Julia brings to the screen. His eyes bug out, his nostrils flare, it all works amazingly well. And it shows just what a tremendous talent he was. Julia brought a lot of himself to the role, even doing some ad-libbing here and there. For example, when Sagat realizes that Guile is still alive, and Bison covers up one eye to say, "But I guess you didn't see that, did you?" That's all him.
I guess you didn't see that, did you?
He made that up on the spot. His performance is so over the top, he's basically in orbit. And his costume is worth the price of admission alone. Think Darth Vader, but with bigger shoulder pads and a cape that's more fabulous than practical.
Yes, he was clearly having a lot of fun in the role. Goofing around, enjoying playing the part of this big over-the-top villain, he gave the role everything he had, far more than the role had any right to have. And he was playing this role for his children, who must have given him all the background information on the character and preparation he needed. It doesn't matter how silly or cheesy the line is, Julia pulls it off perfectly, with gravitas and plenty of scenery chewing.
I'm actually surprised there was actually any scenery left.
once he's finished gobbling it all up.
Exactly, yes.
Van Damme, on the other hand, was a complete pain in the arse. If D'Souza was checking with Julia if he'd taken his meds every day, he also had to check if Van Damme was off them.
Allegedly.
Jean-Claude Van Damme would appear on the set late at times, interfered with the script, interfered with the production, and would actually yell out cut when his own scenes were being shot and demanded retakes. Which, you know, isn't that the director's job? And in addition to all that, he was also having an extramarital affair with co-star Kylie Minogue behind the scenes.
Allegedly. Okay, seriously, we don't want to be on his bad side.
Throughout the movie, Van Damme gave a performance that, even by his acting standards, was just painful and stilted. When it came to action scenes, he was certainly more than capable, but anything that involved him speaking or interacting with other people was another matter entirely. It's only when he has an interaction with Bison that his performance speeds up to a crawl. But even then, his delivery is all the sincerity of a motivational speaker at a timeshare sales seminar.
Come out from behind the curtain, wizard. Let's see how pure your combat really is.
Despite the poor reception and the fact that D'Souza has never directed another movie again, the film, bizarrely, is still considered to be a success. It made back its original budget of $30 million three times over. It was released during a very, very hectic Christmas period, and it was competing against the likes of Dumb and Dumber and that other cinematic masterpiece, The Santa Claus.
It's made money for him as this film, but it's still making money for Capcom now. Is Street Fighter. There's people still out there buying the DVDs and the Blu-rays for this. So it was no mean. It was not a box office flop. It was a moneymaker.
It is a moneymaker. That's the interesting thing about it. They haven't done another Street Fighter movie since this one.
Well, one thing that Street Fighter did do was actually set things up for a sequel. This was before the Marvel Cinematic Universe started putting in those post-credit scenes. We do actually get a post-credit scene in Street Fighter before Marvel started doing it. It sets the scene for a sequel, one that would have perhaps focused on maybe a smaller group of characters, possibly more focus on Ryu and Ken, with Blanka and Dalsim presumably coming back, having survived the explosion, but now changed due to the mutagens to be more like their video game counterparts, complete with stretcher limbs for Dalsim. And that was all from what we sort of get in this sort of post-credits scene.
And of course, it will be Bison that will be back as the villain, as shown in the aforementioned post-credits scene. Bison is revived once again amidst his ruined command center and punches his way through his stack of TVs to try his hand at world domination one more time.
However, that didn't happen. On October 16th, 1994, Raul Julia was taken to hospital with intense abdominal pains and would suffer a stroke that very same night. 8 days later, he passed away due to complications from the stroke. Any thoughts of a sequel to Street Fighter were unthinkable after this. Raul had actually passed away before the film was released, so this post-credit scene was removed from the theatrical version. However, after being released on home video, this scene would later be reinserted back in. All of the versions feature a simple, heartfelt tribute to him as the film ends and the credits begin rolling. For Raul, Valor con Dios, meaning go with God.
So, a couple of things to consider that Capcom was aiming for a PG-13 rating to appeal to teenagers who played the games, but originally the film ended up being rated R, which is ridiculous when you think about it. Capcom considered that to be, far too high. After cuts were made, with some blood edited out and Vega's death cut out entirely, it ended up being rated G. So now it was considered to be too low. So obligatory swearing was added into the film during post-production to keep it in line with the target audience.
4 years of ROTC for this shit.
While some movies had bad language cut out, this film actually had it added in.
Rather than going for any homages or remixes of the iconic theme music from the game, we instead get lots of action military orchestral themes and loads of hip-hop for some reason, including a certain Mr. MC Hammer, whose song Straight to My Feet features in the end credits. There's also a music video for this where he and Van Damme are dancing awkwardly in a club whilst out on a double date, before the club is then stormed by Zangief and a number of other baddies from the film. Considering how iconic the theme music is for the likes of Guile especially, Ryu, Ken, Chun-Li, etc., in the video game, to not use that in the film seems like a massive missed opportunity.
It's really, really silly. So Capcom later enlisted the help of a company called Incredible Technologies, irony, to create a new arcade game based on the movie to be released. So yes, we are talking about Street Fighter the movie, the game. I'm gonna fall into a black hole here. So it's the game based off of the movie that was based off of the game. Bear with me on this one, because you're probably having the same thought that I am. Don't they already actually have a game that they can sell the movie on as well as the movie selling the game? It's a wonderful thing. It's called Street Fighter 2. It's just our Street Fighter 2 Turbo. There's the game. But oh, no. They wanted to go back and do another one. Henceforth, we have Street Fighter the movie, the game.
The game.
It is the epitome of pointlessness. Movies based off of video games tend to be, number one, crap.
Yes.
And video games based off of movies tend to be crap as well. So, when you've got both of these factors working against you, it makes you wonder why this game even saw the light of day.
So, we never got a sequel to the movie, but we did get a cartoon.
Oh,
an animated series, a dreadful Saturday morning cartoon that was supposed to follow on from the events of the film. However, its attempts to fit in with the continuity doesn't really work at all. DJ and Balrog are now working on opposite sides, which makes it more accurate to the video game, I suppose, but it now makes it impossible for the movie to fit in with the show's continuity. Also, due to a combination of dreadful animation, I mean seriously bad animation, ridiculous storylines and awful dialogue delivered badly, this series has become well known for being in a number of internet memes and YouTube videos. In particular, one moment where Bison gets very excited.
Oh, this is delicious! Yes! Yes!
Richard Newman, who was the voice of Bison in the animated series, was very much like Raul Julia, in which he was obviously having way too much fun with the role. Coincidentally, like Julia, this also ended up making him the best acted character in the show.
You killed my...
Yes, yes, I killed your father. What is it with you women anyway? I killed my father too, and you don't hear me whining about it.
And then, of course, if you're a fan of the video game, then the only animation adaptation even worth considering is the almighty Street Fighter II, the animated movie. Now, this provided a great story, concentrated mostly on Ryu and Ken. Bison was still prominent, as was Guile and Chun-Li. Very, very much so in the case of Chun-Li. But other characters were sensibly kept to smaller cameos. It makes sense because Ryu and Ken were the main characters in the game, something that the 1994 movie should have stuck to.
Also, the English dub of that just packs it full of unnecessary swearing.
Bison, I'll rip your fucking heart out, you filthy bastard! Afraid I don't have one.
Because nothing says early 1990s manga releases than, you know,
excessive swearing.
Excessive swearing.
Yeah. But this 1994 version, whilst at the time, was considered to be a bad movie. These days, it now does hold a very special place for many fans of the popular video game and just cheesy action movies in general. It's certainly not the worst video game movie ever made, absolutely not. That distinction should go to, we mentioned it several times now, the Super Mario Brothers movie, or Mortal Kombat Annihilation, or any of the crap that Uwe Boll directed. It's a flawed masterpiece, but my God.
It's flawed. I don't know whether or not it's a flawed masterpiece, or whether I would use the word masterpiece.
But you can't help but be entertained by it.
It's a good attempt.
Yes. Right.
Yes.
Off to the pub then.
See you in a bit.
Of course.
Right, hello there.
Hello.
Different venue from usual. We are in the Pixel Bar in Leeds. Toss a coin to you, each.
Yeah.
I thought that was...
That's not a euphemism.
Wow. Toss off your witcher.
Again, what you do in the privacy of your own home has absolutely nothing to do with me.
Street Fighter the movie. A movie that I think we can all agree is by all means awful, but due to, surely, from Raul Julia alone, from the performance of Raul Julia, it's certainly memorable, if anything.
He's always got a lot of goodwill with him as an actor.
Yeah.
I mean, a lot of it is to do with sort of his turns as Gomez Adams in the Adams Family, because they are awesome. Yeah. Anytime Raul Julia turned up in the movie, you knew he was going to give everything. Because he was that kind of actor. He was a really genuinely, genuinely good actor.
He was,
sadly missed.
He was a professional to the end. He never told anyone on the set of Street Fighter that he was suffering from stomach cancer.
He never
told him about the pain that he must have been in.
Oh God, he must have been horrendous.
He must have known that this was going to be his last film.
Yeah.
And that's why he took it on, because he wants something that, to star in something that his kids want to watch. His kids are huge fans of the video game.
Yeah.
And that's part of the reason why he did it.
Yeah.
I think it speaks a lot about Raul Julia's professionalism. And I think it speaks a lot about Jean Claude Van Damme's lack of professionalism. Because it's like, my God, Raul Julia's literally dying on the set of this film, and he's still conducting himself in a better way than Van Damme did. Allegedly, you know, had a coke addiction, allegedly was having an extramarital affair with Kylie Minogue.
Allegedly, I want to feel as though Kylie had more taste. I can't think badly of Kylie.
No.
I can't think badly of Kylie. I love Kylie. I genuinely do.
Well, everyone wouldn't. Exactly. But for what you can say about Street Fighter the movie, it was certainly a memorable movie.
Oh God, yeah.
Even if it's memorable for the wrong reasons. I mean, these days, when we're doing video game adaptations, in the case of Fallout,
yes,
they actually do a decent job of it, where care is taken to the source material, people that actually played the game of working on the adaptation, whether it's a film or a television series.
Yeah.
So care was taken. With Street Fighter the movie, a certain amount of care was taken. I mean, I draw your attention to Bison's quarters, where he's got different hats based on the different like colour palettes.
Yes,
So attention
with
was...
beautiful, beautiful smoking jacket. Like,
yes.
It is very, very nice. It will be interesting to see. It is kind of like that in later years, with Fallout, which was out this year, with The Last of Us, which was out last year. Still haven't watched that, I need to catch up on it, to be honest with you. Even up to and including... I thought Assassin's Creed didn't do that bad of a job, to be honest with you. It didn't adapt one of the video games, which you can either look at as being a positive or a negative. But that should have been, Assassin's Creed as a whole should have been stronger to do something like that.
Yeah.
Didn't exactly hit the mark completely, but I thought it was a really, really good attempt to do it. Back then, in 1994, we had Super Mario, you had Mortal Kombat, you had Street Fighter,
you had Double Dragon,
you had the collective works of Uwe Boll.
We're not revealing any Uwe Boll films on this channel, by the way.
So you draw the line of Uwe Boll?
Oh yeah.
Oh, that's where you draw the line?
I will sit here and I will review Godfrey Ho movies and The Apple and fucking Virgin Witch.
But you draw the line with Uwe Boll.
Uwe Boll is where I draw the line.
That is so good to know.
We're not doing any Uwe Boll movies. If you're thinking about doing Alone in the Dark or House of the Dead, no, you can get fucked. You and I are going to fall out.
I love
you, mate, but you and I are going to fall out.
Are you afraid of your dad?
Fuck off.
Vengeance shall be mine, everybody. Vengeance shall be mine. No, I really wouldn't do it either.
That means you're going to watch it as well.
Well, that's fine. Will it cause you pain?
See, I get a perverse sort of enjoyment from watching The Apple and Godfrey Ho movies.
Yeah, because you know that I don't like it.
If you're expecting me to review Alone in the Dark with you, you're not going to get any perverse enjoyment, are they? You're going to be like, why am I doing this to myself?
Well, there we go, ladies and gentlemen. It's fun. It's rubbish, but it's fun.
It's fun. You can watch it and you can enjoy it. It's Street Fighter in name only. It's a loose adaptation.
I mean, strangely enough, Future Cults is more Street Fighter than Street Fighter.
It is.
And they didn't have the bloody license for it.
No. Fucking hell, in Future Cops, Dalsim gets to do more in Future Cops than what Dalsim did in Street Fighter the movie.
Exactly.
What does Dr. Dalsim get to do apart from getting his shit knocked out of him?
Not a great deal.
Does it do a single yoga fire? Does it throw a punch? But one thing you can say is that it is memorable at least. So,
oh hell yes.
Join us in raising a glass.
Yeah.
We raise a glass to Street Fighter. To Stephen E. D'Souza for putting all this shit in the first place. Yeah,
no wonder you never directed another movie.
I can't say I blame you. We raise a glass to Ming-Na Ren. I mean, thank God things turned out for you better than this. We raise a glass to Kylie Minogue. Maybe because it's Kylie Minogue and I can't say a bad thing about you.
No, you can't.
And of course, we raise a glass to the late, great Raul Julia.
Yeah.
This might have been the last film that you ever appeared in, but my God, you went out in style. With that, we draw this episode to a close.
Yes. So, thank you very much for watching our inane dribble, as always. As always, there is the usual gubbinsy stuff that's probably around right here.
Leave a like. leave a comment, subscribe to the channel, ring that notification bell to get updated whenever I have a new video up for you to watch.
Yes.
Share this video far and wide across your social media. And whilst you're at it, you can follow me on my social media gubbins as well. We are on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, I refuse to call it X, fuck you Elon Musk. We are on Just Eats, we are on Uber Eats, we are on OnlyFans.
We're really not on that last one.
It's just a picture of Luke's face at this point.
Wow.
We're on Tinder, Grindr.
No, we're not.
Pornhub.
We're really not.
You name it, we're on it.
No, we're really not.
Give us a few months, my friends,
yeah,
to sort out where our new recording place will be.
Going to be.
Because we as of now, I think we've been kicked out of the bunker.
We have been kicked out of the bunker.
And we need to find a new place to record.
Yes.
So bear with us and we will find a place to do it.
Yes.
Until next time.
Right.
Let's raise a glass.
Cheers, mate.
Do all that social media bollocks that I told you about before. And we will catch you.
It's really nice though.
We will catch you next time. Magic Rock. Magic Rock Brewery.
Magic Rock.
We support local Yorkshire breweries.
Lovely.
Right. We'll catch you again next time.
See you soon, guys. See you soon.
Toss a coin to your witcher, O Valley of Plenty. O Valley of Plenty. Ooh.
You have a beautiful voice.
Oh, thank you.